So today, we're going to talk about, are you a burden to my spirit? Are you a burden to my spirit? And a lot of times, like I tell y'all, or have told you all, that my life is an open book. And why is it an open book? Because I don't want to be like the name brand preachers with the fame and the fortune. And people think I'm perfect at all times. I get everything right. And usually, when I do tell you something, you may not get it straight. But we're just going to talk about this straight because something happened to me yesterday. And we should talk about it because being leaders, and like y'all know my favorite verse, Paul said the things we happen to us are for the furtherance of the gospel. A lot of times we kind of carry people spiritually as leaders, basically because we spiritually look and know what's wrong with that person behind them, but then we know, or you should know if you're using wisdom, some people you can't say nothing to or try to help until a particular time because you know they won't receive it. We're gonna be in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, and we're gonna go along with a little story about what's happened to me yesterday. Cause like I tell people, if you in my life, you gonna be a revelation sooner or later. I don't know when you coming, I don't know how you coming, whether it's good or it's bad. You gonna be a revelation. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 1 said, "For yourselves, brethren, know our entrance in unto you that it was not in vain." Verse 2, "But even after that, we had suffered before and were shamefully entreated, as you know, at Philippi. We were bold in God to speak unto you the gospel of God with much contention." That means friction, power, stuff like that. So yesterday, my landlord called me. I don't know how this tie into that, but the Holy Spirit picture, I pick it up as I go on. See, sometimes you just, what the Bible say, he'll give you the words to say as you go on. Because most time when y'all hear me preach, I don't write down notes 99% of the time. I just look at the scripture and he give me what to go out ahead. So this should tie in, but I had to talk about it for some reason. So yesterday my landlord called where I used to stay. We used to be my lifelong friend, and I'm gonna give y'all a little background on it. It's because y'all done seen me move sometime, everything be smooth sailing and yada yada, and I'll be there. So last year I was down here in Tallahassee. And she picks up the phone with Dietrich. "I'm tired of my condo. I want to sell it. I need more room." Because how you women are. She has stuff everywhere. "You want to come down here and take it over? We might think about selling it to you and all that." I said, "Sure." So we made a date, and it was good timing because my lease at my place in the Tallahassee was up. If this boy, y'all can go on. But maybe he want me to do it because she probably come back and look at it. So I paid my friend down here, rented a U-Haul. We loaded our stuff, goes down to Atlanta to move into place. So the deal was, she pay half of the U-Haul and for the mileage. When I get to Atlanta, and my friends pay him for moving her stuff out of his place, even though I was gonna help him, I paid him for moving my stuff, driving, and putting my stuff in his place. I'm making it short. So we get there. We move all this stuff. I get ready to take the truck back. "Dietrich, we need to talk. I ain't got no money." So I didn't say nothing. I said, in my head, I said, "Now, we made this. You said how much I should give him. I told you how much I give him. I said, just give me $50, Dan. So she gave me $50. If you ain't got this man money, why would you allow us to put all that stuff out your apartment, do all this, and we get put all the stuff in where you going, and you want to hand me $50 on a cross-country U-Haul? Y'all know a cross-country U-Haul expensive, plus the mileage when you go over the mileage. I didn't say nothing. I end up paying the boy twice, thinking maybe she'll get my money. Call me the next day, I'm going out to eat with my sister now. But you didn't have enough money. You get what I'm saying? So what that mean, DJ? I was shamefully entreated. This a woman that called me for spiritual advice, for relationship advice, everyday advice. I write books. I say, hey, come get you a book. So I'm sowing into you spiritually and helping you spiritually and naturally, but I understand the spiritual walk of this person. See, as leaders, this is tied it good. As leaders, you should know the walk of everybody in your congregation. Jesus did it. That lets you know when you have a spirit to have people under you, as we shall say, or in your care. I teach people, when you see me somewhere and I just set up a truck, I'm going to let you sit there for a month or two. If God doesn't give me a word for you, if God don't show me your life or your lifestyle, where you're going, you don't belong to me. Because I don't want you listening to me because you like how I preach, you like how I teach, you like the people, you like the fellowship. Your leader has to have a word for your life or a direction for your life personally. Anybody can come into church and say, this the word God gave me. That's a general word. If you look at the Bible, Jesus set the disciples down, and sometimes Jesus talked to them personally. That's what a shepherd do. And see, so now I'm in Atlanta, living good. You know, I'm in the condo. She come to get the rest of her stuff to rent a van. I said, yeah, I'll help you. I help her put the rest of the stuff in there. She didn't pay me for that. Y'all see how the money rolling up now? I'm going to get to the good point before we get on back into this. All right. So January comes around with Dietrich. I got to sign another lease. You sure you're going to be there? Do you want to buy? I said, yeah, I want to buy. Well, let me find the papers and we get everything together. And we'll see about you buying it. But you sure you gonna be there? I said, yeah, I'm gonna be here. I said, I ain't going nowhere. I said, I like my place. A one bedroom condo in Buckhead and you a bachelor, you live a life. Right in the middle of it, where everything go on, all the shopping center. Look out the window, I can see the Fields Plaza and the mall. So here come February. With Dietrich, I wanna come back home. When can you be out? How can you be a landlord and call, even though I'm your friend, how can you be a landlord, call me with such disregard for the plans that I have made, with such disregard for how it going to inconvenience me, because had I knew this was going to happen, why would I leave Tallahassee? What that mean? That mean I just wasted money moving down now. Wasted it. But I never said nothing because people that know me now, you know I'm very confrontational. But sometimes I just try to keep the peace. I say, okay, let me just do this. So I said, where I'm going to go? I said, you know I ain't got nowhere to go. Well, I'm going to look for you a place to stay. How can you spend my money? And I said, that's a selfish woman right there. You going to look for me a place to stay? How you know what I like? Your spirit ain't my spirit. So you supposed to been finding you another place, but because you too cheap to buy what something costs, you gonna look for a grown man a place to stay? I ain't your child. So I was pissed off then, but I held my tongue. So I just said, that's okay. You know the lease over with in July. I said, but I'm gonna move as quick as I can because any of you know, if you stayed in a place and you know something wrong or something went on and you got to go, you're no longer comfortable in that place because you can't sleep. And I couldn't sleep, so I found another place in Tallahassee, speeding it on up. I moved here. So I told about the little things that I left undone in the place because I was trying to get out of there. You know, so once again, I had to come all the way to Tallahassee, got my friend, brought him all the way back to Tallahassee, and I helped him to a point of loading all my stuff up again. Watch this. So when I called her to tell her I'm finna move, I said, okay, I found me a place in Tallahassee. I'm getting ready to lose. You can't move that quick. Y'all heard what I said. You can't move that quick. You can't do that. You just called me, asked me when I can be out. I told you I'm going to get out quick as I possible. What possible? So now I'm finna move. You telling me I just can't call you up and say I'm finna move? Y'all see the selfish spirit in operation, don't y'all? Because that person tried to make it all about them. And I kind of knew what it was because you might have wanted me to help you get your stuff. I knew what it was. I ain't no fool. I said, well, I got to go have my money roll. And this have my money rolling. So I'm moving out of here. And I did this, this, and that. People, 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 people. Do you know, with everything I had to do, that inconvenience cost me between $5,000 and $6,000 just to move back? It didn't cost me that much the first time. Why? It cost me between $5,000 to $6,000. I had to tell you the price because this was. So she called me with Dietrich. You put nails all in there. You hung these pictures up. And you got nails all in here, and you just got nails everywhere. Exaggerating, because I seen the place, because even though I had nails, I went and bought spackle, you know who it is, and I put the spackle in the holes where the nails were. All it needed was a little paint that would blend it back in, and that was under the kitchen sink the whole time, but I don't paint. I don't know how to paint. So even though it was small, I don't know if it was a special way to do it, so I ain't want to mess it up. With Dietrich, the fan, the first thing happened, the door handle came off. Yep. This all happened while she came in, coming in there. It didn't do all that with me. Then she called me. The little pull chain on a ceiling fan had came out and it broke. I was gonna try to fix it, you know, because I do stuff, but I ain't know how it go. I left it alone. Well, you know, the chain on the thing broke. You left that thing mounted against the wall. You've been in my apartment since I moved in there. You knew my TV was mounted against the wall. I told you I couldn't get it. My friend and them couldn't get it down, rather, because we didn't have the tools and I didn't want to tear the sheetrock. I said, so you can use it or find somebody to take it down and I'll pay for it. But then I got ticked off. I said, anything that's wrong in there, tell me how much it costs, call me, and I'm going to pay for it. That's what I said. Because you seen this up there. You didn't say, Dietrich, you can't hang that on the wall. You've been in the place. See, that pettiness pisses me off. Here you is making probably all kinds of money, and you being petty over maybe $100 worth of work. Then she called, say, we scratched the elevator moving out. We had a stainless steel elevator. It had kind of scratches already in there. And when I helped move the big piece out, which was my sofa and stuff, I made sure I didn't scratch this elevator. So you're going to let this white lady tell you that I scratched the elevator. And I thought about it. I said, when I go down there, get ready to pay them, I want them to show me on the camera where I scratched the elevator. You cannot pick a scratch on the elevator and say I did it just because I moved out of there. I was extra careful because when I moved in, it wasn't no things around the elevator. You didn't say nothing about you had to pay $75 because the elevator got scratched. And in that time, the elevator was scratched because we were moving her stuff out and some of us scratched it. I seen it, but I never said nothing. But you never said the white lady said, I got to do this, I got to do that. See, people with a selfish spirit And a poverty mindset only cares about themselves. They are a burden to us who try to think at a higher level of understanding because, okay, God, I'm not better than you, but I see what you're struggling with. So yesterday she called me, you know, sent a text, call me quick as I call. I hung my clothes in the closet and all the closet rod fell down. You know, they them little cheap wire rods that people put up sometimes. And my all those things fell down. The things was weak. I went and bought new support for them and put them up. I had my clothes and boxes on them before I left. I took them out. So they hung my stuff up there. What you did, she probably had too much stuff on it. And because you got to look at the weight limit of stuff. So probably what you did, you put too much on it and it collapsed. So she calling and telling me that. And y'all, I flew off the handle. My friend of almost over 20 years, my ex-landlord, I cussed a slap out. I'm just honest with you. I said, stop calling me with this petty ass shit. That's what I said. Y'all don't like me. I'm just real with it, you know. Because sometimes being a peacemaker, you hold a peace in so much that it bothers you because you really try to make the person see, do you see what you're doing? So now, this is what I'm going to get to. You keep calling me, telling me how much everything costs, but for me to move down there, you never said nothing, but I need to pay him. Was I fair in what I gave? You know you weren't fair in what you gave me. I spent over $200 in gas driving it down there. I gave the boy $400 or $500 for moving. Not that ain't saying nothing about the $300 or $400 I paid for. I spent almost $15,000 to $2,000 moving down there, and you gonna give me $50? But then you wanna keep calling me, telling me what's broke? If you have the spirit of God, you should say, hey, well, I ain't gonna worry about this. Let me go and fit. Then being a landlord, if that's what you call yourself, things like that happen when you rent out property. You know, if you didn't charge no deposit, you fix it yourself. So I went slap off. I said, listen here. Just tell me what everything costs. Do not call me or text me until you know what everything costs. Send me what it costs, and I'm going to pay you. I never said I wasn't going to pay for it because why? I was trying to cheat the peace. But then when you come nagging me like like somebody, a wife, over little petty stuff, and y'all just look at the stuff I named you. The darn hole that the little thing was mounted by was about this big. It needed a 7/16 socket. Two big old dime size hole, but the stuff that was still sitting there, what I used to mount my TV on. Y'all should see when I used to do my broadcast sometimes. Y'all see my TV on the wall. We talking about under 100 stuff, under $100 worth of stuff. And you keep calling, making all petty about little stuff. So yeah, I lost my cool. Because see, something wrong when people try to get every nickel and dime out of something that they deem when they deem wrong. But then you done screwed me out of so much money, and they ain't never said what I need to do right by Deidre. Watch this. So you complaining, talking about I don't supposed to mount stuff, but I got a brand new $60 shower head in that bathroom with that one on it, and you ain't never, watch this, you ain't never said, well, did you, let me pay you for that. Because the shower was raggedy when I moved in, and you never fixed it. You kept trying to fix the darn thing. I said, let me do it this way. Brand new, sitting up there with the little shower thing holder that you can put all your stuff in. She didn't have now. That was another $20, $30. That's $100 down. Why I'm saying this? Because a lot of y'all got petty people in your life that you try to keep the peace with, but sometimes their pettiness get to you. Now, I teach people the right thing. I said, no, don't stoop down to your level. I wasn't stooping down to her level. Now that I think about it, I was exploding. Why? Because the years of our friendship and everything I may have asked you to did for me, I paid you back. Not once has she ever did something to me. Oh, you owe me this. Listen, people. I remember years ago, I came from Birmingham to Atlanta. We drove a big Penske truck to Ohio to move her mama down here to Atlanta. She's supposed to pay me and didn't even pay me. And that was years ago. Never said nothing about it. So, Mr. Landlord, if she count up the money, you owe me a lot of money. But I never said nothing. People petty for no reason at all. See, a lot of y'all dealing with situations that you need to say something to them. Or you need to say, hey, you know, that ain't, you know, I don't like the way you're doing me. See, when you sit and hold stuff in, and God told me that 2 years ago, you kill yourself from the inside out. You kill yourself. Because sometimes you have to you got to tell them. Because, see, I wasn't really finna say nothing about this. And then I went on social media and I seen a little meme. It said, if you're allowing it, then don't complain about it. If I'm allowing this girl to do this over these years and I never said nothing about it, then I shouldn't have been complaining about it. So being the man that I am, I called some of my friends up. I said, hey, this is what I did. And I said, I don't feel bad about it. I didn't feel no Holy Spirit conviction to pick up the phone and say, hey, well, I shouldn't have did that. So I'm sitting there praying last night. He said, Dietrich, you human. He said, everybody got a boiling point. He said, why should you get mad for express your feelings just because it didn't come out Christ-like? He said if you would have expressed your feelings Christ-like, your point really wouldn't have got made, because you would have to speak to it in a Christ-like manner, which you would have got through. But by blowing up, now it caused her to think, because she said, well, what is Dietrich going through? Because if I never talked down to this person, I never got mad at this person. So for all these years, for me to blow up like that, she should be sitting there. Well, why would he do that? So she sent me a little text message after I blowed up. Well, Dietrich, I thought we were better than this. You just did my place in a kind of way. Still being petty, but I'm done. But now, see, a selfish person and a poverty-minded person are the worst kind of spirits to deal with, because they don't want to never feel like they being wrong or take advantage of, but they taking advantage of us. Yesterday I kind of went through a lot of stuff. And I've been saying, I was telling my friend, I said, when I pay her for that place, I'm going to have to tell her what she did. I had been saying it in my spirit. But then to keep calling me, telling my disc broke, that broke, fix it. It ain't like you ain't got the money. But see, she didn't see the inconvenience in me. And I'm thinking about the $1,000 I had to spend moving. And you ain't saying one with Dietrich, I'm sorry, I thought I wouldn't want to move. See, that familiar spirit came back around. See, she came back. What the Bible said, the dog will soon return to his vomit. And come. The house was nasty when I moved out of it. I had to clean the darn house while I was moving out. That apartment probably never ain't been that clean. I went in there and washed walls and everything. You should have seen all the dust and the filth that was in there. But I never said that. What you trying to say, Hubbard? If somebody close to you is getting on your nerves, go ahead and tear them off before you blow up on them. Y'all be blessed.